Johnson's Motor Car. Twas down by Brannigan's Corner, one morning I did stray. I met a fellow rebel, and to me he did say, "With orders from the captain to assemble at Drumbar, but how are we to get there without a motor car?" "Well, Barney dear, be of good cheer, I'll tell you what we'll do. The specials, they are plentiful, the IRA a few. We'll send a wire to Johnson to meet us at Stranhar. We'll give the boys a bloody good ride in Johnson's motor car." When Dr. Johnson got the news, he soon put on his shoes. Says he, "This is an urgent case, there is no time to lose." He wore a fancy caster hat, and on his breast a star. You could hear the din all through Glenfin of Johnson's motor car. But when he got to the railway bridge, he saw the rebels there. He knew the game was up for him, at him they did stare. Says he, "I have a permit to travel near and far. To hell with your English permit, we want your motor car." "What will my loyal brethren say whene'er they hear the news? My card has been commandeered by the rebels at Dunluce. We'll give you a receipt for it, all signed by Captain Marr. And when Ireland gets your freedom, you'll get your motor car." We put the car in motion then and filled her to the brim, with guns and bayonets shining, which made old Johnson grim. And Barney hoisted the Sinn Féin flag, which fluttered like a star. We gave three cheers to the IRA and Johnson's motor car. When the black and tans got word of this, a solemn oath they swore that they would have reprisals before the day was o'er. They searched for hill and valley, they searched both near and far, but the IRA was far away in Johnson's motor car. They searched for hill and valley, they searched both near and far, but the IRA was far away in Johnson's motor car.